Good morning, everyone. Bladen Breitreiter, incident meteorologist, here with Jasmine to give you a weather update for the Hermit's Peak and Calf Canyon fires for Thursday, May 19th. All right, so overnight we saw some pretty dismal recovery, generally getting into the 30 to 40% range here across the southern zone of the fire. And then as we get up into the northern zone, it got a little bit better, getting up into the 50% area for our maximum humidity. Keep in mind, that is basically the moisture recovery that we see overnight, and it's a good indicator of things like the burn window and whatnot as we go into the afternoon hours. So the cool thing, not really the cool thing, but an interesting thing that I saw that became my favorite thing to talk about for overnight is up at Chacon. So we have a little weather station up there, and overnight in around the 4 a.m. to 6 a.m. hour, that guy got up to 50% humidity. Now, as of this recording, which is around 9 a.m., that guy had already dropped to the teens. I believe he was at 15% before I got here. So that's definitely an indicator of what we can expect going into the day today, that at 9 a.m. we're already in those low double-digit relative humidity values. So, chapstick warning in full effect, but also have a red flag warning today issued by the National Weather Service in Albuquerque, and that is going from 1,200 until 2,200. So we're going to be seeing a lot of exceptionally dry conditions, and we're going to start to see those strong winds come back into play as we get into the day today. Now, the strongest winds are, of course, going to focus themselves across the high terrain, and that's where we're likely to see the more sporty conditions, getting into those 40 to 50 mile an hour range. Now, I would not be at all shocked, because I do forecast for this area for my day job, to see that also manifest here at Las Vegas, because it loves to overperform when it comes to winds. But in and around the majority of the perimeter here, and especially across those more sheltered areas, you know, we'll be seeing things getting more into, you know, gusts around 35 to 40, maybe localized to 45. As we get up, you know, into the Moro River Valley kind of area, that is where we'll see a better reduction of those winds. There's more. I couldn't find it. There he is. So they're a little bit more sheltered. They're kind of nestled in between a lot of complex terrain. And so they're more likely to see a reduction in that, getting a little bit closer into that 30 to 35 mile an hour range for gusts. All of these are going to be coming majority out of the west. Down here in the south zone, you can expect to see a breath of south. And then, of course, as we get up a little bit further, you know, north into the central and north portions of the fire, that's when we start to see a little bit more of a due west and then a breath of north. So, what's causing this? Get rid of my magic sword. Cool, it stayed. All right. So, we're actually looking at what is called the Air Mass RGB. It's a really rad satellite product that we get that can actually distinguish not only between cloud cover, moisture, but also the temperature of those air masses that are coming in. So it's real cool for when we have cold fronts and the like, or really cold air masses coming in, that we can actually differentiate that in a graphical format. So what we have here is a tale of two upper-level, low-pressure systems. So there's one down here in the Baja of California, and then way up here, you can just barely see it, we have another spinning low-pressure up in Canada that is slowly working its way down. Now, as you look at the satellite product, obviously you can see the clouds here, and you can kind of make out some cooler colors, kind of getting into the blues here, and if we could see a little bit further up, we would be able to see some of the blues in there as well, and that's an indicator of that cooler air mass that is starting to work its way down. Down where we are here, you see kind of an olive, dark orange, and that is an indicator of a warm, dry air mass. So this guy up here is going to dig on down into the Great Basin as we go into the rest of the week here. And then he's going to pivot, and always they just want to kind of eject east and get out to the Great Plains. This guy is going to continue to move south, and it's going to make our pressure gradient system in here a little bit baggier. So it's actually going to kind of help us, because we're not going to quite have that super, super tight gradient that would give us some of those more rambunctious winds. But we're still going to see some rambunctious winds with this system, starting with today, getting into that more 40 to 45 mile an hour gust range, and then tomorrow we'll see it step up a little bit into that 50 mile an hour range. So in addition to that, you can see a lot of cloud cover here. We're going to see an influx of lower and mid-level moisture, and even really some high moisture. High moisture will come earlier into here first, and you can see that as evident here by these high clouds. So I'm talking a lot about upper level lows and low level moisture and all of those things. And so I want to touch back on something I talked about during my last tour, which was the atmospheric nacho theory. Now, it's something I developed for kids, but adults seem to like it too, because they have much more passionate opinions about their nachos. But it's a good way of describing how meteorologists look at the atmosphere to make a forecast and to try to understand what is happening to our weather systems locally. And so we look at it often in terms of a surface, 700 millibars, especially in this country, 500 millibars, and then kind of that 300 to 200 millibars. Now, if you notice, it's getting less and less as I go up, and that's what pressure does. As you increase in height, pressure decreases. So the atmospheric nacho theory is, at the surface we have our nacho layer. So it's kind of the more stable, solid sort of situation going on. As we get up into the 700 millibar layer, that's where we're gonna see our salsa. We can use that to consider our moisture. So a lot of the things that we're dealing with, especially in this area, that low-level moisture is what we really want to see and is going to affect us the most. Getting to that mid-level, that 500 millibar layer, that is where the majority of all of our sensible weather comes from. That's where those upper-level low-pressure systems, those upper-level disturbances, those are where those reside, and that's where our beans are. Then at the top of the atmosphere, the 300 to 200 millibar layer, we're going to put our sour cream. That's going to be the jet stream. So if I stir that up, take that sour cream layer and just really mess things up, it's going to affect everything below it, because sour cream is thick and likes to just grab onto stuff as it moves. So we stir it up, our jet stream is going to change things at that 500 millibar layer. The 500 millibar layer is those beans, so it's a little bit sturdier. It can knock that moisture around down at that 700 millibar layer. We often talk about lift. You've heard me talk about that a lot. So short wave troughs are at that 500 millibar level. Troughs also at that 500 millibar level. So that's our sensible weather. And as we disturb that and as we change it, we're going to see the majority of the impacts to our sensible weather. And then, of course, as we get into that moisture layer, that 700 millibar layer, that's when we see all the different changes, the cause and effect. We see that get disturbed there at the moisture level, and that can come on down to the surface. Now, it's a very, very simplified metaphor, and it's definitely not a perfect metaphor, but it's a really good introduction to trying to understand the vertical profile of the atmosphere and how changes in those different layers affect what we see here at the surface. Now, going into tonight, because we do have that trough coming in, I'll walk back over to it so you can kind of see what's happening here. We have that coming in, so here's that upper level disturbance here in that 500 millibar range. Here is also those winds that are very strong aloft. That's going to continue to dig down, and because of that, we're not going to see what we would usually see at night with that inversion setting up and those winds going to bed. Instead, they're going to stay up and they're going to party for a lot of the night tonight, and we'll see good breezy to locally windy conditions persist as we get into the overnight hours. By tomorrow, this guy will have made it quite a bit further south, and so we'll get a tighter pressure gradient, we'll get stronger winds aloft, and because we don't have any of those inversion processes happening, those stronger winds aloft are going to have no problem getting on the roller coaster and coming straight down to the surface and doing so pretty early in the day. So we have two critical fire weather condition days coming up, Thursday today, Friday tomorrow. So definitely be sure that you do your part. Don't burn anything. Don't grill today. Don't disregard your cigarettes. Don't weld if you can help it. You know, do everything that you can to create one less spark, because the last thing we need is one more fire starting. So that's all I have for you guys today. I will see you tomorrow.